I'd like to welcome Guillermo Ulises Ruiz Esparza, who has the passion needed to succeed in finding new cures and also to lead the new generation to research. I can witness some of his work, and I can assure you he's the rising star. He's going to talk about molecular nanosystems and their applications in medicine. He holds both medical doctor and bio-nanotechnology degree, and is a pioneer in field of cardiovascular nanomedicine. Currently, he directs a molecular nanosystems research group in the division of engineering in medicine at Brigham and Women's Hospital and Harvard Medical School. He received many awards, but since we are at MIT, I will mention that MIT Technology Review recognized him as one of the world's top innovators under the age 35. He received his MD and PhD degree in biotechnology and nanotechnology from the Montreal Institute of Technology. Welcome, and you can't wait to hear
Thank
about
you.
Nanomedicine again.
Thank you. That's amazing. I'm very happy to be here again after some years. Today I'm going to talk about how we can apply nanotechnology, or in this case, drug delivery to different types of cardiovascular diseases. But first of all, I would like to start talking about the central issue of drug delivery. Right now, in the clinic, when you wanna deliver a therapeutic, in this case to a specific tissue that has a disease, there are several barriers that need to be passed in order for that drug or therapeutic to arrive to that targeting site. So we have, of course, physical barriers and biological barriers. Some of them are based on enzymes that can degrade this drug. The reticoendothelial system, endothelial barriers, interstitial fluid pressures, cell membranes, nuclear membranes that actually prevent the drug from arriving to the targeting site. If you think about how drugs right now interact in the body, actually they are very, very inefficient. For every 10,000 molecules that we actually get inside our bodies, just one arrives to the targeting site. That's kind of very, very inefficient. Like, why that happens? Because most of these drug molecules degrade or they arrive to other sites, producing side effects. That is especially true, actually, in cancer. When cancer cells are not exposed to enough chemotherapy, what happens is that they expand, and then they create metastases. To be honest, we have actually very effective drugs that can kill cancer. Chemotherapy can actually be very, very effective. Nevertheless, the real problem is not the biology or the mechanism of action of these drugs. It's more like a physical problem. Why these drugs are not arriving in the right place at the right time? Potential strategies exist. Right now, there's a lot of new therapeutics that are being developed based on drugs that are conjugated with molecular recognition ligands, trying to increase the specificity and the transport of these drugs to different types of tissues. Or there's a new type of therapeutic area that is based on nanotechnology, where we are developing nanoparticles that in this case can encapsulate drugs and can be able to cross these biological barriers to target the specific tissue. There's also a combination of these two fields trying to increase the specificity of current therapeutics. In the case of nanoparticle delivery systems, one of the things that we are actually developing is how to encapsulate these drugs in a very efficient manner. So when this agent is encapsulated in the drug, it's able to be transported through the body and then arrive to the targeting site. It can be a tumor, it can be another disease in a different organ. And then when these nanoparticles arrive to the targeting site, they're engineered, in this case, to enter inside the cell. When these nanoparticles get into the cell, they detect the macroenvironment of the cell, and they start releasing the therapeutic cargo. Several advantages exist of how, of why these nanoparticles might be very useful for different disease states. In this case, they can overcome these biological barriers by increasing the penetration of some of these drugs. They can protect the degradation of the drugs, and at the same time, they can increase the biodistribution of some of them. This, in turn, will increase efficacy and also decrease the side effects of a lot of therapeutic agents. Unfortunately, the drug of the field of nanomedicine actually has been applied mainly to cancer. And in other areas, such as cardiovascular disease, there's still a lot of limitations. Basically, we're using a lot of traditional medications that haven't been very effective. I can say that in the area of heart disease, every minute, someone will die from a cardiovascular event, which is terrible. There's one very, very challenging disease that is called heart failure. Basically, in this disease, the heart is unable to pump enough blood to other tissues. And it's one of the leading causes of mortality worldwide. In its chronic state, it kills more people than all cancers combined. It's the number one cause of hospitalization, and is the most expensive pathology in the healthcare system. During the last 30 years, there's no innovation in the field for heart failure. I can see that no therapeutics have been developed. All the therapies that exist are mainly palliative. The only option is heart transplantation. Nevertheless, not enough hearts exist. And of course, there's no cure for heart failure. In the last decades, like nanotechnology has arisen as an option to treat cardiac disease. New therapeutics have been developed, in this case for myocardial infarction, and also for other cardiovascular pathologies. But the field has been advancing very slowly. I can tell you that to date, there's no therapeutics in the field of cardiovascular disease that are right now in clinical trials or in the market. So why is this happening? Actually, I can tell you that there's a very big lack of innovation in the field. This, for me, this image represents how the people is approaching cardiovascular disease right now. I can tell you that they are thinking inside the box, not really outside the box. And with the advent of new technologies like the genome editing technology CRISPR-Cas9, new opportunities can arise for cardiovascular disease. Nevertheless, there's a lot of limitations. One of them is, how are we going to deliver CRISPR-Cas9? Maybe this could be a very good option to create a new set of regenerative therapies in the heart. But it's very difficult. So with this in mind, maybe there should be a good strategy that could serve us how we can transport this sequence to specific tissues, like the heart. And maybe the answer or the inspiration can be in other technologies that we have built as humanity. So I'm gonna tell you something. How did we arrive to the moon? It's a very interesting story. And I'm gonna start talking about this story with this man here. His name is Mauro Ferrari. He was my mentor during my PhD. He's a very prolific scientist. He's the pioneer in the field of nanotechnology applied to medicine. And when I was working with him, I had the chance to really envision how to make more efficient the transport and delivery of different types of therapeutics to different regions of the body. We got inspired in how, in this case, NASA was launching rockets to space. We were thinking, how can we develop a technology that is going to be able to transport in a very efficient manner different types of therapeutics? We started in cancer, and then we applied this technology to cardiovascular disease. The inspiration was the multi-stage rocket booster technology that exists in the rockets that allow them to actually reach higher distances or deeper into space. This technology was necessary because at the time, a single rocket was not enough to launch these spacecrafts. They needed a multi-stage system with multiple rockets to achieve great distances. So with this in mind, we thought that we could adopt a similar approach to transport therapeutics, in this case, to the heart. So we work into a multi-stage delivery technology that actually was based on silicon-based microvectors. It was a very interesting technology that, as you can see in this image, the way it was developed was actually nanoparticles can be encapsulated in the pores of this microsystem. And then what is going to happen is that when we inject these nanoparticles to the human body, they're going to be able to traffic through the circulatory system. And the first stage is going to arrive to the vasculature. And then when these microparticles arrive to the microvasculature, they're going to be releasing a second stage. They're going to be the nanoparticles. So these nanoparticles are going to be able to penetrate deeper into the tissue due to a smaller size. And then as a third stage, the nanoparticle is going to be able to deliver the therapeutic cargo. This cargo can be a drug, can be a gene, can be a protein. This was a very interesting technology that I had the opportunity to work with, was actually mathematically modeled in geometry and size to bypass all these biological barriers. And it was inspired by the shape of the red blood cells. That's why it's a discoidal microparticle. So the trafficking through the circulatory system is much better. It has enhanced margination and enhanced drug delivery. So we load these nanoparticles inside the pores, and we try this technology to see if we could achieve what we wanted at the beginning. We wanted to deliver microparticles to the heart. In this period of time, actually nobody had tried before to deliver nanoparticles to a failing heart. So we tried for the first time to use nanotech to see if we could deliver therapeutics inside the cells, in vitro, but also in vivo. As you can see in these images, these are cardiac cells, and you can see how these microvectors are attaching to the membrane, and then afterwards, they are migrating inside the cell. Same happens in vivo, but also happened in vivo. After injecting these nanoparticles intravenously, they were able to traffic and arrive to the nucleus of the cell. This result was actually very, very encouraging because with this, we are right now developing different types of therapeutics that hopefully are going to be able to arrive to the cardiovascular cell and deliver therapies like CRISPR-Cas9. I'm going to go very quick. I know that the time is very short. I'm going to put you another example of how nanotechnology can be used in other cardiovascular diseases. This case, postoperative adhesions is a very big problem. Right now, most therapeutics that exist don't prevent adhesions. What happens with adhesion is that after a surgical intervention, there's a fibrotic barrier growing in between the heart, and in this case, the the pericardium that actually can have a lot of different problems and complications, side effects like myocarditis. Also using nanotechnology, one of the things that we actually created was a hydrogel that could serve as a coating to the heart and that will enable us to deliver therapeutics in a local manner to prevent postoperative adhesions. The existing technologies hasn't been very, very effective, have very low efficacy. They have a lot of limitations, and unfortunately, they have failed. So one of the things that we have developed are these kind of shear-thinning and self-healing hydrogel technologies that have the ability to heal. We use these hydrogel technologies as coatings, where we apply them in the surface of the heart, and then we encapsulate drugs in them, and we sustain release these anti-inflammatory drugs to prevent inflammation and adhesion formation. These nano-engineered constructs have shown enhanced efficacy compared to products in the market that exist right now. And one of the very interesting things about these hydrogel-based technologies is that are all based on nanoparticles. These are nanostructured hydrogels. So one of the very good opportunities that we have with these hydrogel technologies is not just the adhesion prevention, but also the opportunity of deliver drugs in a more localized manner compared to other technologies that exist. We have seen very good results, very good enhanced, actually, anti-inflammatory effect around the pericardium. And also we hope that this strategy could serve as a secondary method of delivering drugs in a more localized manner. From my perspective, I believe that nanotechnology is going to play a fundamental role in the development of new therapeutics and also new imaging technologies for cardiovascular disease. I think that is the ability of nanoparticles to be delivered to the heart in a very specific manner. It will allow the transport of different types of materials, like drugs, proteins, of course, genes. And of course, the development of hydrogels that could be locally injected into the heart will allow also the local delivery of different types of therapeutics to prevent adhesions or even treat other types of diseases. You could even be thinking in delivering cells directly to the heart. I know that the time is short, so I just want to conclude with this, and I want to thank you about the invitation. Thank you so much.